U.S. President Joe Biden vowing an ironclad commitment to defend the Philippines in the face of China's growing maritime aggression. The Philippines, U.S. and Japan set to open a so-called Luzon Corridor of Investments after the trilateral summit happening in Washington. Former President Rodrigo Duterte denies conceding anything to China during his administration. And petroleum prices seen heading higher for a fourth straight week. I'm Stanley Palisada. Dateline Philippines begins right now. For those of you joining us or watching us on YouTube and Facebook, glad you could join us. We begin in Washington, D.C. and the historic trilateral summit between the U.S., Japan and the Philippines, where long simmering tensions between China and its neighbors took center stage. We have this report from Voice of America correspondent Chris Casquejo.
U.S. President Joe Biden reiterated his vow that the U.S. defense agreements with the Philippines and Japan are ironclad. So let's start with the Philippines, which is a key part of the U.S. defense strategy in the region. No troops from the U.S. are permanently stationed there, and the U.S. and the Philippines have a mutual defense treaty that dates back to 1951. Last year in 2023, they agreed upon four additional sites under the 2014 Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement, EDCA, to provide additional staging capacity for U.S. military, where U.S. troops rotate their presence no more than 10,000 at a time. And the Philippines also needs to retrofit its military assets, so to that end, the U.S. Senate has proposed $2.5 billion in grants over 5 years to help Manila purchase weapons from Washington.
Today, we mark a historic moment, the first ever leaders summit between the United States, Japan, and the Philippines. And it's truly an honor to have you both here as we begin this new era of a partnership. And today, we commit to writing that story in the future together, to building the Indo-Pacific that is free, open, prosperous, and secure for all. And I want to be clear, the United States defense commitments to Japan and to the Philippines are ironclad. They're ironclad. As I've said before, any attack on Philippine aircraft, vessels, or armed forces in the South China Sea would invoke our mutual defense treaty.
We meet today as friends and partners bound by a shared vision and pursuit of a peaceful, stable, and prosperous Indo-Pacific. It is a partnership born not out of convenience nor of expediency, but as a natural progression of a deepening relation and robust cooperation amongst our three countries. This is a meeting that looks ahead. As we deepen our ties and enhance our coordination, we seek to identify ways of growing our economies and making them more resilient, climate-proofing our cities and our societies, sustaining our development progress, and forging a peaceful world for the next generation.
Now on to Japan, which has 50,000 U.S. troops stationed there, but command and control for those forces is located in Hawaii. The U.S. and Japan committed on Wednesday to better coordinate their military command and control with some reforms. And this is all in the hope of discouraging China's so-called gray zone tactics, like firing water cannons in the West Philippine Sea or South China Sea and aiming military-grade lasers at other vessels. Reporting from the White House, Chris Casquejo, VOA News.
Meanwhile, the trilateral summit has concluded, with Manila receiving several pledges of aid from Tokyo and Washington, including the opening of an economic corridor in Luzon. Katrina Domingo has the story, and she's reporting live from Washington, D.C. to give us details. Kat, go ahead.
Hi, Stanley. The Philippines trilateral partnership with Japan and the United States is expected to produce more jobs and more investments that will ultimately benefit Filipinos. That was the guarantee of U.S. President Joe Biden during the trilateral summit that happened here earlier. Now, based on the joint visual statement that was released after that historic summit, the three countries have agreed to open the Luzon Corridor, which is basically a string of investments and developments that will connect Subic Bay, Clark, Manila, and Batangas. Among the Luzon Corridor projects that the U.S. and Japan will help fund are the Subic-Clark-Manila-Batangas Railway System, the expansion of the Clark International Airport, and the Clark National Food Hub, which will be the central drop-off point for agricultural products in the region, both for export and domestic consumption. Now, the Development Finance Corporation, which is the United States' financing arm for developing nations, will also open its first office in the Philippines to help steer the development of the Luzon Corridor. Let's listen to a portion of President Biden's speech.
The first corridor can end up with people across the entire region. It needs more investment. The sector is critical to our future. Clean energy, ports, railroads, agriculture, and much more.
Now, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. underscores that Manila's cooperation with Tokyo and Washington came from their shared vision and pursuit of a peaceful, stable, and prosperous Indo-Pacific. Let's listen to his statement.
It is a partnership born not out of convenience nor of expediency, but as a natural progression of a deepening relation and robust cooperation amongst our three countries.
Linked by a profound respect for democracy, good governance, and the rule of law.
This is a meeting that looks ahead. As we deepen our ties and enhance our coordination, we seek to identify ways of growing our economies and making them more resilient, climate-proofing our cities and our societies, sustaining our development progress, and forging a peaceful world for the next generation.
Stanley, the Japan and the U.S. have also committed to provide training programs for Filipino students who wish to work in the semiconductor industry to help the Philippines expand one of its most profitable sectors. On the defense front, the three allies condemned China for its illegal presence and dangerous tactics inside the Philippines' exclusive economic zone. The three countries have also agreed to mount joint naval training exercises, including maritime drills around Japan in 2025. The joint vision statement also mentioned the three countries' united stance on the civil and safe use of nuclear power, as well as a vow to uphold democratic values, human rights, and gender equality. Stanley, so far, we expect to get more details about this trilateral partnership later on, as President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is expected to answer several questions from the media tomorrow before his return flight to Manila. Stanley.
All right, we're looking forward to those developments. Katrina Domingo again, thank you so much for the updates. Joining us now to give us his thoughts on the historic trilateral summit between the U.S., Japan, and the Philippines and other recent issues involving China is maritime security expert Mr. Ray Powell. Mr. Powell, welcome to Dateline Philippines. Thank you so much for talking to us.
Thanks, Stanley. It's great to be with you.
It's good to have you here. Now, let's hear about your insights on the recently concluded trilateral summit. What do you wish to give? When you talk about the topics, the subjects that were tackled there, you have economy, you have defense. Did you hear what you wanted to hear as far as defense is concerned?
Well, I heard what I think I expected to hear, which is the reassurance from Japan and the United States that they stand squarely with the Philippines in its troubles in the West Philippine Sea. And of course, the reiteration of the U.S. commitment under the 1951 Mutual Defense Treaty. But you know, the U.S. is really now trying to draw in its other allies to create more of a mesh network of allies so that it's not just the U.S. as the hub and, you know, the Philippines and Japan as individual spokes, but now they're beginning to mesh together. And we see this happening even with the commitment toward a reciprocal access agreement for Japanese and Philippine troops, hopefully to be concluded by the end of the year.
All right. This seems to be the first time that, you know, things are officially brought out and, you know, countries are bonding together to have this common agenda. Now, do you expect more countries, particularly claimants in the South China Sea, because they've been unusually silent through all of this?
Yeah, I don't. I think that ASEAN countries will probably remain very quiet. They have different sort of motives and motivations, and their populations see things differently. But I think that what you will see is an increasing involvement of other U.S. allies. We're looking at joint sales, not just with Japan, Philippines, and the U.S., but also, of course, Australia, I expect that probably we'll see other European countries join in those joint activities in the West Philippine Sea. Of course, in Balikatan, we're going to have a French ship. So, you know, I think that there will be a lot more involvement from other powers, not necessarily ASEAN powers, which don't seem to be able to get together much on security issues.
All right. So we've been hearing really about the joint exercises for the past couple of years. Now, what about actual military assistance or aid packages? Did you hear anything substantial on that?
Well, of course, there was the commitment of, pending congressional approval of additional foreign military assistance to the Philippines, and that huge $2.5 billion package that was introduced in the Senate, which hopefully will go toward approval in the Congress and signature by President Biden. So that would be very substantial indeed. Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, Mr. Powell, how do you think this will change China's stance now? I mean, do you expect them to be more aggressive after this as a result? Because we know China had been warning about these engagements.
Yeah, it's almost hard to see how much more aggressive Chinese ships could be, because they've been stepping right up to the limit of what could be considered an armed attack. And that's one reason that the U.S. Avoids making specific red lines, because what you find is when you make a red line, China will do everything up until that line. So if you say that an armed attack has to involve, for example, the firing of bullets, then they'll do everything up until the firing of bullets, just to test to see what your mm-hmm. actual lines are. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think that China could try to punish the Philippines in other ways. It could try economic or trade kinds of punishments. It's done that before. But at some point, China has to ask itself whether all of this is really worth it, or whether all of this barbaric activity in the West Philippine Sea is causing it more problems than it could possibly solve.
All right. Now, Mr. Powell, how aggressive now do you think should the Philippines, Japan, and the U.S. be after the trilateral summit? I mean, what immediate changes in behavior do you wish to see in the way these countries work together in the South China Sea?
Well, I don't think you're going to see a sudden step up. I wouldn't necessarily see U.S. or Japanese naval ships patrolling near Ayungan Shoal with Philippine ships. I think that would just sort of give China the pretext to escalate themselves. I think that the Philippines will probably continue to exert itself in moderate ways and not give up the moral high ground that it has. Mm-hmm. I do expect that the Philippines will begin to explore other ways to try to get supplies to the BRP Sierra Madre, to try to mix up its tactics using other methods. I wouldn't want to necessarily speculate as to what those were, but trying the same thing over and over again is certainly leading to some frustration among the Filipino people, mm-hmm. but it's also leading to an incredible amount of international support to the Philippines, which is exemplified by this trilateral summit, which I have to say, I give all the credit in the world to the Marcos administration for its transparency campaign, which I really believe brought this about. Mm-hmm. The fact that the President Biden and Prime Minister Kishida invited President Marcos on the heels of the Prime Minister's state visit to D.C. Is indicative of the fact the whole world now is paying attention, and these two large powers want to lend their assistance.
All right. Mr. Powell, I'd like to go back to what you mentioned earlier about China having other ways to retaliate. Now, this might include some allegations of Chinese sleeper cells already in the Philippines, or even China recruiting Filipino military to join their forces and their activities. Are these possible at this juncture?
Of course. I mean, spying is not new in the world. And in fact, we recently discovered an American sailor who was arrested for spying for the Chinese not very long ago, just a couple of months ago. Uh-huh. So, yeah, it's entirely possible. It's one of those things that all countries have to be alert for. You don't want to overreact and assume that there's a spy around every corner, but you still certainly have to build up your resilience against these kinds of activities.
All right. Now, let's take a contrarian view here. What do you think of ideas or opinions that the Philippines should not have trusted the United States, since it is not even a signatory to UNCLOS? It is not a party to the dispute, that it only pushes for its own interests and that the Philippines has become a willing pawn in the U.S.-China rivalry. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, the first thing I think is that that just denies the Philippines all agency, as if the Philippines is duped, as if honestly, it's accusing the Philippines of being stupid. And I think that's just offensive. Hmm. Secondly, all countries act in their own interests. What makes the U.S. and Philippine alliance strong is that not only do they have common values, but they share a convergence of interests. So, you know, a lot of those things are simply talking points coming out of Beijing, which seeks to divide and conquer. It wants to sort of deal with every smaller nation individually so that when it walks in the room, it can sort of outweigh the other and sort of force them to negotiate on Beijing's terms. So it despises any kinds of groupings that might make smaller countries more networked, more formidable in a negotiation. And what the Philippines is doing is very wisely increasing its leverage.
All right. Lastly, how far do you think China would go at this juncture?
Well, you know, that's the million-dollar question, right? What deters China? And, you know, we used to, I think, have a better idea of what this was under Xi Jinping. That's been a little less clear. China is on a little bit of a charm offensive. It's been trying to make nice with a variety of different countries that it's had differences with. And I think that at some point, you know, China will have to realize that this is, you know, this kind of, you know, picking this fight over sort of what's really just kind of a minor annoyance of this rusty ship on a shoal cannot possibly be serving China's interests. In fact, what it's doing is galvanizing the world against it. And so, you know, if it wants to continue to sort of, you know, improve its relations so that it can concentrate on more important things like its economy and its demographic problems and other kinds of things, then it really needs to put this to bed and find a way to climb down off of the escalatory cycle it's put itself on.
We're really looking forward to how this would pan out in the South China Sea. Again, Mr. Ray Powell, maritime security expert, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon for your insights.
Thanks, Stanley.
Moving on, former President Rodrigo Duterte is setting the record straight on his alleged gentleman's agreement with China. During a press conference aired on SMNI's Facebook page, Duterte said he conceded nothing to China during his administration. But he says Manila and Beijing did agree to maintain the status quo in the West Philippine Sea.
Aside from the fact of having a handshake with President Xi Jinping, the only thing I remember was that status quo. That's the word. Na walang galawan. No movement. No armed patrols there. As is where is. Para walang magkagulo. Hindi tayo magkagulo. Yun ang naalaala ko.
Cayetano Alan. A Senate probe on the alleged deal has been sought, with some critics of the former president calling the agreement treasonous and unconstitutional. President Marcos also said he was horrified by the deal. China again calling on the Philippines to honor a supposed promise and an agreement in their maritime row. Beijing insists the Philippines reneged on its promise to tow away the BRP Sierra Madre from the Ayungin Shoal. It also slams the Philippine government for denying reaching an agreement with China during the Duterte administration. China continues to claim Manila is, one, provoking Beijing by bringing construction materials to the BRP Sierra Madre, the lone Navy outpost of the Philippines in the West Philippine Sea.
China has been working with the Philippines to manage the situation on the Rinnai Reef through dialogue and consultation. The reasons for the current situation on the Rinnai Reef are clear and obvious. If the Philippines truly wants to ease the situation on the Rinnai Reef through dialogue and communication, it should honor its promise, abide by consensus, and stop provocations.
In other news, former President Rodrigo Duterte revealing the possible location of fugitive pastor Apollo Kibuloy. Duterte said Kibuloy might be hiding in the Kingdom of Jesus Christ's properties in Tamayong Village in Calinan, Davao City. But Duterte warned it may be challenging for authorities to search the area given its vast size. Duterte's revelation came after he denied he is coddling and hiding Kibuloy in his house. The former president also said he would not accept the pastor if he will surrender to him. Coming up next, local pump prices heading higher for a fourth straight week. That story and more when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with ANC. Back on Dateline Philippines, Philippine transport regulators vow their readiness for the looming transport strike to be launched by groups opposing the government's PUV modernization program. Jeepney groups Manibela and Piston will be holding a series of protest actions against the controversial modernization scheme beginning Monday, that's April 15. The protests will conclude on April 30, the deadline for jeepney operators to join a cooperative which will replace their fleet with safer and less polluting vehicles to improve the transport system as a whole. The LTFRB now reminding protesters to conduct an orderly strike.
Pinaghandaan na po namin yung paglalagay ng mga rescue vehicles po sa mga possible areas na magkakaroon po ng problema. There are about 4 areas po na natukoy po namin na pwedeng magkaroon po ng shortage sa public transport. Magpapakalat po kami ng mga MMDA po at saka police to maintain peace and order. Kasi po ang palagi namin napapansin, hinaharang po yung mga pampublikong sasakyan na wala naman pong balak sumama sa kanila. Kuminsan ho nagtatapon ng spike sa daan para po yung mga goma ng mga ayaw sumama sa kanila ay mabutas po.
The Philippine National Police says it will launch mobility assets to aid affected passengers.
Bibigay po natin sa kanila yung araw na yan, of course, but we will exercise as usual yung maximum tolerance para naman po hindi po magkakaroon ng anumang gulo kung darating po yung araw na talagang magrarally po sila sa mga kalsada po natin.
President Marcos earlier this week asserted the finality of the April 30 deadline, echoing remarks from transport officials who say nearly 80% of jeepney operators have already consolidated. A local jeepney manufacturer sees the PUV modernization program as a chance for the Philippines to industrialize. Francisco Motors says instead of importing modern jeepneys, the government should focus on local manufacturers, which it claims can build better vehicles. The local firm also reveals it will be building a 200-hectare special eco-zone in Camarines Norte, where other local manufacturers can produce affordable e-jeepneys.
Jeepney manufacturing of Francisco Motors is just a tiny part of the bigger project that we're doing because we are developing a special economic zone, a 200-hectare special economic zone in Camarines Norte, of which the jeepney manufacturer is just one of those locators in that economic zone, wherein we are inviting all of the suppliers in the supply chain of the manufacturing of electric jeepneys to locate in that special economic zone. So This endeavor will generate a lot of jobs for Filipinos here at home, of which if we continue to import minibuses from other countries like China, India, or wherever, we are taking away jobs that are supposed to be for the Filipino workforce.
Francisco Motors also explains its ambitious plan to provide operators with free modern jeepneys.
Pwedeng sumali dito ay yung mga jeepney operators with valid franchises. So it could be ano, yung mga transport cooperatives, transport corporations. Lahat ng sasali, meron sila mga lumang jeep. Diba? So yung mga lumang jeep nila, we can still use them to operate them and help them na lumaki yung kita nila. Because we will have the unlimited rides na, ano, na tickets. Kapag sumakay ka ng train, you can buy a ticket, you can hop on, hop off unlimited times in a day. Or in a week, or in a month. So, depende sa ticket na bibiliin mo. So, kung kayang gawin nyo ng developed countries, why can't we do it here? Ang problema kasi ng, ano, ng mga operators natin is the cost ng mga sasakyan. So, kung ang problema nila ay cost, bakit ang solusyon is hindi pa utangin? Diba? We create a business model na hindi yung lulubog sila sa utang. We create a business model that is sustainable enough that we can actually give the jeepneys for free. So dito sa unlimited rides tickets na to, dyan kukunin yung sweldo ng mga drivers, dyan kukunin yung kita ng mga transport cooperatives.
The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority clarifies the modified working hours for government offices in the metro is not rigid. LGUs in Metro Manila were mandated to adjust working hours in government offices to 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. from the current 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. window starting Monday, that's April 15th. This is part of government's efforts to ease traffic congestion in the region during rush hours. But MMDA says government agencies can still implement other schedules best suited for them.
Yung 7 to 4 naman general rule po yon, pero pwede naman po mag-adjust ang LGU, ang mga government agencies, kung ano yung suited sa kanila. Meron pong nagsasabi na mas preferred nila yung 4-day work week, pero ang nakasentro po ito na 7 o'clock magsisimula na po yung servisyo publiko at natatapos po ng 4. Yung iba naman po ang gagawing 4-day work week tapos alternate po para lang po maikalat yung ating mga empleyado sa mas maraming oras o araw para po hindi po magkasabay-sabay
Opo.
Sa pag-commute.
Meanwhile, the Metro Manila Council says some government workers will still stay in their offices until 5 in the afternoon to cater to the public as they adjust to the new schedule.
Hindi naman po makaka-disrupt sa serbisyo ng lungsod ang isang oras. At mag-iiwan naman po tayo ng skeletal force from 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. for frontline services. Dahil baka meron pa rin mga darating po between 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. Asahan po nila na meron pa rin skeletal workforce na may iwan po sa City Hall.
Now, 6 Philippine municipalities are expected to endure dangerously high temperatures today. That's Friday. State Weather Bureau Pagasa says the areas, including Puerto Princesa City in Palawan and Cotabato City in Maguindanao, will experience a heat index of between 42 to 51 degrees Celsius. Under these circumstances, Pagasa warns heat exhaustion and heat cramps are likely, while heat stroke is possible for those exposed for extended periods. The months of March, April, and May are usually the hottest for the Philippines, but temperatures have been worse due to the prevailing El Nino phenomenon. This has prompted labor groups to call for so-called heat breaks and schools to suspend in-person classes. Some bad news for motorists. Oil prices seen rising for a fourth straight time this week or next week. The Philippine Energy Department expects gasoline to increase by up to 20 centavos, while diesel and kerosene may climb by as much as 1 peso next Tuesday. The DOE still attributes the higher pump prices to the ongoing conflict in the Middle East, particularly in Gaza. The National Food Authority Council has approved a higher buying price for unhusked rice, locally known as palay, to stay competitive. Under the new guidelines, dry palay can be bought from 23 to 30 pesos per kilo, while fresh palay will have a buying price of 17 to 23 pesos. This is higher than the previous 19 to 23 pesos buying kilo or per kilo buying price for both fresh and dried unhusked rice. The move comes after NFA reported it has been struggling to procure palay this harvest season due to lower prices compared to private counterparts. Aside from the approval of higher buying prices, the NFA Council also approved a program that will modernize their operations. The Philippine National Economic and Development Authority calling for improvements of the Philippine internet infrastructure to ensure that all sectors benefit from fast-evolving AI technology. Andrea Teguines has details.
From converting audio to text, summarizing a 100-page document, to analyzing huge amounts of data, all in just a few seconds and with just a single prompt. These are just some of the ways artificial intelligence can be used by different industries in the Philippines, as demonstrated in a workshop organized by USAID in partnership with the National Economic and Development Authority and the Philippine Competition Commission. Filipino journalist and Nieman Fellow at Harvard University J. Mark Tordesillas said AI-powered language models like ChatGPT can even be customized to fit a certain organization's purpose. Just like how he made a custom GPT to help investigative journalists sift through complex audit reports.
You can customize custom GPTs for things like legal documents or environmental reports or even transcripts of hearings or meetings, etc. And it's up to any newsroom or any organization to figure out how to use the tool to put in the guardrails to make sure that the AI isn't, you know, doing a general scan of the whole document, but that you're only using it to search for the exact information that you're trying to look for.
But like with any new technology, great power also comes with pitfalls, like issues concerning copyright and misinformation.
It's going to make the lives of us in the media much, much harder. But I think it also gives an opportunity for everyone to be more skeptical of everything they read or see on the internet. And so it might be a time to try to get people back to using mainstream sources that they could trust.
For the Philippines competition watchdog, algorithmic bias is another thing to watch out for as more companies adopt the use of AI.
For example, I don't want to mention any apps, but you know, if you are, for example, if you're browsing in the search engines, baka yung mga possible lang algorithms that would result to kind of a collusion between companies na nag-invest sa isang AI, for example, and the result of that will prefer a preference to for example, buy their products, kasi yun lang yung mauuna again doon sa mga advertisement.
According to the PCC, as of March 2024, ChatGPT already has 6.3 million users in the Philippines, which boosts the need for policies to ensure the responsible use of AI. Tordesillas said this initiative will require the participation of all stakeholders.
I don't think it's going to be effective if it's just the government telling everyone this needs to be done. The different industries, for example, us in the media, we need to have positions on what we can ask for when we talk to policymakers and regulators about these industries. It's important to engage the technology companies, to press them on what kind of guardrails they can put into their technologies.
NEDA, meanwhile, pushed for better internet infrastructure in the country to make sure all sectors can benefit from AI technology.
Before we can talk about taking advantage and harnessing the benefits of all the technologies has to offer, we have to make sure that the digital infrastructure is enabled. And One of the main structural reforms that we have been pushing for, that NEDA has been pushing for, with the support of the PCC, of course, is the Konektadong Pinoy Bill.
The Konektadong Pinoy Bill aims to modernize the Philippine telecommunication laws. Number one, it proposes to remove the franchise requirement for telecom players. So as you know it, madugo yung pagkuha ng prangkisa sa Kongreso. So it's a political process.
AI is projected to be a $1.8 trillion industry by 2030. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
A cybersecurity analyst's call on the Philippine Congress to craft laws regulating artificial intelligence. Art Samaniego says it will be prudent for lawmakers to create measures addressing the risks of AI, since it would likely be used for disinformation campaigns during election season. He warns AI technology will continue to improve, making it even harder to spot manipulated videos and images.
We don't have a comprehensive law that covers all these things. So wala tayong batas dito. Ito yung danger. Election is soon coming in the Philippines, so this could also be used for disinformation. So few months from now, the technology or the technique will be really improved. So ito ngayon ang delikado sa atin.
A venture capitalist meanwhile urges governments to proceed cautiously with AI regulations to foster greater opportunities without stifling innovation. Nations have been actively pursuing the regulation of the new technology due to its potential to surpass human intelligence, which could result in unintended consequences. In November last year, 25 countries, including the U.S., China, and those from the European Union, agreed to collaborate on developing a unified approach to AI oversight.
There has been a lawsuit or regulatory lawsuit from Europe. One of the countries has fined Google for indexing their content and turning it into AI. And it's hundreds of billion dollars worth of fines. Europe has put forth very stringent regulations around AI from US-based countries. Now, the upside of this is it protects their culture. The downside is it reduces the opportunity for innovation in their own cultures. So countries' instincts are to regulate technically Silicon Valley and the Seattle area where a lot of these technologies are coming from.
Yeah.
But they need to be careful. If they do this in the wrong way, their entrepreneurs are not going to want to build the AI models in their own country.
Right.
They're just going to flee and come to the West Coast United States, which is happening in abundance.
World news now. Russian missiles and drones destroy a large electricity plant in Kyiv, or near Kyiv, and hit power facilities in several regions of Ukraine. The Russian Defense Ministry says it hit fuel and energy facilities in what it describes as a massive retaliatory strike. Russian President Vladimir Putin says Moscow was obliged to launch the strikes in response to Ukrainian attacks in recent weeks on energy targets in Russia. He adds Russia refrained from carrying out such attacks in winter out of humanitarian considerations. Kyiv's appeal for urgent air defense supplies from the West have grown increasingly desperate since Russia renewed its long-range aerial assaults on the Ukrainian energy system last month. Hamas leader Ismail Haniyeh denies his sons were killed in an Israeli airstrike Wednesday where fighters in the group's armed wing. When asked whether their deaths would impact ceasefire talks, Haniyeh says the interests of the Palestinian people are placed ahead of everything. He adds Hamas is still seeking a deal, but Israel has been evading a response to their demands. The killing of Haniyeh's sons was coordinated by Israel's military and intelligence service without consulting top commanders or political leaders. That action is seen to complicate efforts to free hostages still held in Gaza. Israel bracing for possible retaliation for the killing of a senior general and six other Iranian officers in an airstrike in Damascus on April 1st. Israel's military spokesman says civilians were not being told to make any special preparations, but adds Israel is highly prepared for a range of scenarios. Most Israeli troops have been pulled out of Gaza in preparation for an assault on the southern city of Rafah, where more than a million Palestinians are sheltering. But fighting continues in various areas of the enclave. The U.S. remains concerned about the risks of escalation in the Middle East following threats made by Iran towards Israel. The U.S. State Department says Secretary Antony Blinken has asked counterparts in Turkey, China, and Saudi Arabia to use their influence to stop Iran from attacking Israel.
We continue to be concerned about the risk of escalation in the Middle East, something we have been working to mitigate and contain since the attacks of October 7th, and specifically about the threats made in recent days by Iran against the state of Israel and the Israeli people. We have been engaged in a series of contacts, not just at his level, but at other levels too, to talk to foreign counterparts to send this very clear message to Iran that they should not escalate this conflict.
Russia also calling on all countries in the Middle East to show restraint and prevent the region from slipping into chaos. The FBI concerned about the possibility of an organized attack in the U.S. following the March 22 deadly concert hall attack in Russia. The attack near Moscow killed at least 144 people, the deadliest in Russia in 20 years. The Islamic State militant group claimed the responsibility for the attack. Now on Thursday, FBI Director Christopher Wray sought to persuade the House lawmakers to boost funding for the Bureau amid security concerns.
This is a time when we need your support the most. We need all the tools, all the people, and all the resources required to tackle these threats and to keep Americans safe. Increasingly concerning is the potential for a coordinated attack here in the homeland, akin to the ISIS-K attack we saw at the Russia concert hall just a couple weeks ago. We also need funding to counter the threat from the People's Republic of China, a government sparing no expense in its quest to hack, lie, cheat, and steal its way to the top as a global superpower and to undermine our democracy and our economic success.
American football star and actor O.J. Simpson, who was acquitted in 1995 of murdering his former wife, has died at the age of 76 after a battle with cancer. Simpson was one of the best and most popular athletes of the late 60s and 70s. He parlayed his football stardom into a career as a sportscaster, advertising pitchman, and Hollywood actor. But things took a turn after Nicole Brown Simpson and her friend from Ron Goldman were found fatally stabbed outside her Los Angeles home in June of 1994. Considered the prime suspect, Simpson was cleared by a Los Angeles jury in what U.S. media call a trial of the century. But he was found responsible for her death in a civil lawsuit and later imprisoned for armed robbery and kidnapping.
And it's kind of tragic and sad. And, you know, for such a talented guy, and he was a lovely guy when he was at SC and, you know, previous to that. So whatever happened with the drugs and the relationship and, you know, the trial and everything else, it's just kind of a sad, tragic end to his life, which could have been so much more.
Not going to miss him.
How do you think the wife?
I don't have any personal animus to him, but I just think I don't have any hatred toward him, but I think he murdered his wife and he got away with it.
In Peru, cases and deaths from the dengue epidemic there have more than tripled so far this year. According to government data, the number of deaths from dengue rose to 117 in April, compared to just 33 in the same period last year. Suspected cases have also swelled to 135,000. The government has declared a health emergency, unlocking economic measures to strengthen the strategy against the epidemic. Switching gears now, here's a tale that's straight out of a movie. Now, three men who were stranded on a remote Micronesian island for over a week have been rescued. The three set off on Easter Sunday for Micronesia, but they encountered problems with their boat and got stranded on the Western Pacific Island. Their niece reported them missing, launching a coordinated rescue effort involving the U.S. Coast Guard and Navy. They were found thanks to a help sign, which they spelled out on the beach using palm leaves. There's another twist to the story, though. Turns out one of the rescuers is a relative of one of the castaways. Now, how's that for an unexpected family reunion? And before we go, NASA is now preparing to return men to the moon after half a century. And soon they could be joined by four-legged robots who are undergoing training to walk on the lunar surface. Take a look.
This is Spirit, a robot that is being trained to walk on the moon. Scientists are testing it in the rugged terrain of Oregon's Mount Hood in preparation for future missions in space. The research is part of the LASSEE project, which stands for Legged Autonomous Surface Science in Analog Environments. Cognitive scientist Christina Wilson.
Moving forward to missions that are going to occur on our moon, we're going to have humans and robots really for the first time on planetary missions working side by side. And so what the LASSEE project is doing is really looking forward to that time and considering how should humans and robots collaborate for exploration of planets, particularly where should they go to collect data.
The idea is to teach Spirit how to cope with difficult and changing terrains in the same way humans do, such as walking from hard or rocky surfaces to soft ground like snow or sand.
With every step that the dog robot takes, it's able to sense kind of mechanical resistance with its leg, kind of similar to the way that when we walk on uneven surfaces as humans. And what's very cool is that scientists are interested in that data because it tells us things about how planetary surface formed and how it moves and how it might move in the future.
The LASSEE team is comprised of experts from NASA, Texas A&M University, Georgia Institute of Technology, Oregon State University, Temple University, and the University of Pennsylvania. The group has a two-year, $2 million grant to help NASA put teams of robots working together on the moon.
And that'll do it for today. Thanks a lot for joining us. I'm Stanley Palisada. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on the YouTube channel of ABS-CBN News and here on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe, everyone, as you keep it here on the news channel.